OffPlanet Media.
You are listening to OffPlanet Radio at offplanetradio.com.
Good evening and welcome to OffPlanet TV. Whenever, wherever you are, however you hear this, see this, or partake of what we are about to offer this evening. We're probably a little giddy tonight. That could be lack of sleep, lack of oxygen, or just frankly not giving a flip about the state of the world right now. It is an insane planet, and we're going to pump a little bit of sanity into it, a little bit of hope, a little bit of joy into your proceedings this evening. This is OffPlanet TV. I'm Randy Moggins, and we welcome you. You are hearing this, seeing this at consciousconsumernetwork.tv or offplanetmedia.net. The website for the shows is offplanetradio.com. And yeah, it's a somber world out there if you let it get to you. There's so much going on, and I've been blogging and posting a lot lately about breaking with the consensus reality that you've been given. One of the revelations I guess people are starting to get is the idea that news is theater, that most of what you partake of in media, and this includes mainstream, obviously it includes the alternative media as well to a large degree. A lot of it is pre-digested, pre-programmed drama and theater designed to keep you distracted, depressed, and inactive in doing something to help change the condition of the world. We're each spiritual universes within ourselves. We each have the power to change the world within ourselves, and by extension, change the world as it interacts with each and every other living soul on the planet. That's the message of hope that we have. That's the joy that we hope to bring to you. Two guests tonight, kind of an interesting, we do this once in a while where we do a double header. And first hour with me, you see her on screen right now, is Suz Pratt. She's a YouTube blogger who specializes in spiritual research, basically. We're going to talk about a number of things tonight. And then in the second hour, we are going to be joined by a very lovely woman, Mamta Mishra, who is going to talk to us about autism, her journey with her autistic son. She is known as the Candlemaker's Mother, and it is her quest for completeness in autism and children who suffer from this debilitating, we'll say pandemic at this point, because the numbers you're going to hear in the next hour are staggering. Anyway, we want to bring her up. Good evening and welcome to OffPlanet TV. Suz Pratt, my friend, welcome.
Good evening, Randy. Such an honor to be here tonight.
It's really wonderful to see you sitting there on that wonderful Victorian settee. I don't know the right name for it. My father would have known this because that's what my father did. He restored antique furniture.
Wow.
And that is a gorgeous tapestry and a gorgeous piece of furniture. I feel like we're kind of welcoming you, being welcomed into your home tonight, which is kind of the ambience that you give when your YouTube videos, when you talk. Tell us a little bit about your journey, who you are, and what we're going to talk about tonight.
Okay, Randy. You will come to know me extremely well. And you know, some people say that maybe I give a little too much information, but in order to really be able to do life charting We have to put our own experience into it. And as far as my intro into life charting, I first came across Rudolf Steiner's books back in 2005. And The Human Life was one of those books. So imagine this. I'm still in my old reality where 70% of me was happy. The 30% was what was killing me, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So if I'm going to really get to know myself and go forward with these exercises, we surely understand that the world will be reading it because this was located in my salon right next to my styling chair. When I became a hairdresser, that was by the grace of Creator God. That was nothing I had an interest in. Mm-hmm. But because I loved my friends, if I was going to be working on a client, I surely needed to love them. And so that started a long, deep relationship process. And some of my clients have been with me 30 years now. But the people that are new, that walk in, they are treated and loved and spoken to the same way. So if it wasn't for life charting and what I've learned through this process, I wouldn't be here with you tonight. And I think that with what we all know, that there is a telepathic exchange going on. If I can heal myself, then anybody can do it, because I have been through so many different situations in my life that if I chose to, I could have hidden them, but then how would I have related to the world? So Steiner was very natural for me. In my experience, it lives within me. It's been with me all my life. And the book serves as confirmation of spirit. So when people see me speak and interact on Facebook, I will use that phrase, confirmation of spirit, or phenomenon progress. And I mean it with every bit of my heart brain.
Yeah, if you've posted that to me several times over the time that we've corresponded. Mm-hmm. Let me back you up a little bit, because you've been doing a lot of work on YouTube and a lot of different
subject matter.
Yeah, which leads me to believe that while we're going to talk tonight about life charting,
yes,
Mr. Steiner, there is an all-encompassing aspect to this. Some of the things that we've talked about as well, as we kind of mapped our way towards doing this show, your own journey in the spirit, and the sense that I think we all who are awake, and that's, boy, there's a term that's just loaded,
isn't it?
We have the sense that we're kind of in this very specific time, and many of us have the sense that we have a destiny, that we were born into this time. I don't know about you.
Oh, yes, 100%.
I felt that way since I was a kid.
Yes.
I always knew that I came in here to do something, and I always knew that the age we lived in was very special, that there was something going on. As a kid, I was raised as a Christian. I read the Bible.
Yes.
And, you know, that's a loaded situation as well. Nevertheless, the prophetic side of that always kind of really resonated with me.
Mm-hmm.
The idea that when Jesus said, "Know that I will be with you even until the end of the age," well, that sort of tells you that there's an old age and a new age. So
yeah,
when we talk about new age, we're not talking about, you know, the granola crunching, incense burning, woo-woo people. We're talking about something that's very real.
Last show with the new age girl, did you see that?
I did.
Oh, wait, do you see Biggie's illustration of a granola cruncher new age person? It was awesome.
Yeah, incense burning, crystal waving, new age girl.
Oh, nice. And I've got the crystals, but here again, serious business.
So taking it from there, we're kind of going on a broad path tonight, because we know that we're not going to cover everything we want to cover tonight. We're going to do a second part of this particular talk at a date to be determined, but I want you to be comfortable, and I want the listeners to know a little bit about who you are and what we're talking about. So let's talk a little bit. That book behind you there, can you pull that? Can you show that to us? Can you?
I would love to.
Bring that a little closer.
This is The Human Life. Can you see that?
Got a little bit of glare on it, but that's not,
There Tell we me go. The proper there angle.
We go. There we go.
Okay.
Now we can see it. Okay. This book has meaning to you. This book is very important to you. Explain that a little bit, please.
All right. When Rudolf Steiner walked through his life, I believe that the entire time he was life charting, which is what it's called the biography of a human life. He passed earlier than people expected. You know, his energy was drained down, just like the great Edgar Cayce and other healers and energy workers that would extend themselves, because the collective was so important. Maybe that's something we all need to learn, the life skill. Put ourselves first, and to know it's not selfish.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the big things. So after Steiner's passing, George and Gisela O'Neill came from war-torn Europe, and they actually relocated down the street, from what I understand the story to be, here in St. Louis. When I started to soak up these books, and there was a collection at a used bookstore, and so I would go and I would grab several, and you know, you would get one and look at it, and it completely resonated with me, like I had been there when it was written. Like maybe I even wrote it myself, and I'm not claiming that, but that's the feeling inside when you read a great literary work, right?
Right, correspondence of spirit.
Oh, it's awesome. It's such a synchronicity. So during that time, I was getting to know the people that owned the bookstore. And one day they confided in me that there was, when these books were given to the used bookstore, there was explicit directions. Do not give them to a certain person that was coming to get them. And that there would be someone else coming to get them that they needed to go to. Interestingly enough, my dear friend Brian, that we spoke about that passed, her and her husband had the entire Steiner collection in German at their very home. So the people at the bookstore didn't want them to have these original books, because it would be a double set. Now, this is in English, of course. But every one of these came out of what is called the Magdala Library. Can you see that seal?
Yes, I can.
Right. Every book in the collection. When I began with these books, I knew my life, as I knew it, would never be the same again, because when I was young, I ran with a famous Christian psychic. Her name was Mama Lil, very famous here in St. Louis. She had gifts from Liberace and different stars. She knew Ike and Tina Turner.
You know, people don't know this, but St. Louis is kind of a spiritual hub.
Yes, it is.
In terms of some very famous people. That were, especially back in the early, what I will say, the 30s and 40s, you had the circuit preachers that went out and did the tent shows. I mean, and St. Louis is very large in that legacy in terms of being kind of a hub of spiritual activity.
I've heard wise ones say the St. Louis sits on the third cosmic ray, which is unconditional love. So here I am in Ferguson, where there has been incredible stories of the battle of the forces of dark and light. And I don't mean black and white, Randy.
I mean, absolutely. No, I understand what you're saying. This is not racial profiling. This is forces of darkness and light.
Yes, sir.
The battle, the clash.
Correct. And do you know that when Missouri became part of the United States, or whatever we're going to call ourselves for now, we were forced to come in as a divided state because they wanted to keep an equal balance between the states that were pro-slavery and the ones that were considered to be free. I believe that if there can be peace in a divided state like this, that there can surely be peace across the planet. So that's been my platform for the last 16 months.
That's a pretty fascinating story right there, because you have a, there's a spiritual overlay that occurs. People don't understand that different locations retain energetics of the historical underpinnings. In other words, souls live in a particular geographic place, and there's an imprint that occurs.
Yes,
and those imprints become a legacy, which then kind of circle back again. It's like the attempt to resolve certain, I'll use the word karmic, that's not the best word I can think of, but we'll say karmic.
It is, because it's location wise.
Yes.
Kinds of karma. Yes.
Yeah, it's like geomantic resolution of conflict. There you go. We just invented one. We can now write a book.
Now that was awesome. I wish I had a pen. I'd be taking notes.
That's okay. You can play this back later. Rewind button. But yeah, it is a fascinating thing. And anybody who has ever done any type of, when I was working as a minister, we did a lot of walking through cities and finding places that had dark energies to them.
Yes.
And expelling spirits.
Yes.
You know, this is not exclusively Christian, by the way. This is just the work of people who are ghost hunters. But again, it's the same idea that there is a presence, a spiritual haunting that occurs in specific places. So Ferguson is actually the outworking of a much older cycle of division.
Yes, it is. And back in the day, they actually say that some of the Indians that were involved in the 1904 World's Fair were here in Ferguson at the time. So a lot of the older buildings that are run by slumlords here that are dilapidated, the energy grid is so powerful. Mm-hmm. When I first moved down here, I lived in a building that wasn't suitable for occupancy, and the city full well knows it. But of course, they still allow people to be taken advantage of. And that's another platform I am speaking on at this time. But even though that building was that way, the vibration of love and blessing in that building was the most incredible thing. And the story goes is that the Indians were there and had blessed that land and had been there. Now, in modern day, to jump to a different subject, Missouri has so much to be proud of. Three of my favorite people are right here in Missouri with me. So the first is Dr. Norm Shealy, who's the magnesium guru. Mm-hmm. And if it wasn't for me using magnesium, I probably wouldn't be here, to be real honest. And that goes back to stress and different things, you know, blood pressure problems. The next one is someone who I'm just a huge fan of, and that's Dutch Sims. You know about him?
I do know Dutch. I have actually seen Dutch Sims. He's a prophet. Yeah.
No doubt. And he's probably...
Yes, I've heard Dutch Sims speak. Yeah.
Awesome. He probably lives about 15 minutes from me. We haven't met yet. I hope to become quite close with him as well.
Dutch Sims actually does a fair amount of work of going out and restoring the land. That's a lot of what he does.
Well, and you know, your buddy Wilhelm Reich also did the same kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So we are fully aware and understanding of what that could mean to a town like Ferguson, especially when 10 minutes down the road, we have that underground fire, you know, the nuclear. I've got people that want to move, like, say, 30 miles away. And it's so hard because these people, I love them. I mean, I've watched them grow up. I've watched them have children. And I have to say to them, do you realize that it's going on all over the globe? It's not just here in North County. And if you move to the country, that's where all the underground missile silos are. People have to wake up.
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
And the only way that they can wake up, Randy, is if they allow themselves the grace to find out who they really are. And I think
if I look at distracted for a minute, I'm just adjusting a control here. So please just go ahead.
Oh, I was just hoping that you could hear me because
I am. I've got something bleeding into our signal, and I suspect it's coming from my studio. So I was just fiddling here. I have mixers and stuff. So anyway, let me please continue.
Well, all I know is this. I know what we're experiencing is real.
Yes.
And it's time for everybody, like I say all the time, to create their own reality. So let me move my cat for a second. I wanted to read something as an intro to get to know who Rudolf Steiner is and what he was experiencing.
And not Wilhelm Reich, as I put in the blurb for the show tonight. This is me taking notes on the fly.
These two were buddies.
They were.
I know they were. I can feel it. Yeah. But let me read you something, okay? This is about Rudolf Steiner's personality from a dear friend of his, and it's just a short paragraph. But I think it relates to now. If I wish one thing from destiny, it is that I may not pass by the greatest spiritual phenomena of my day. What are these wishes when they arise in man? Are they a premonition of what is to come? Are they dim remembrances of a charge whispered by our angel when we were relinquished to the earthly world?
Wow.
Yeah. Rudolf Steiner wanted people to be able to read freely, you know, with no big brother looking over their shoulder. Mm-hmm. They wanted them to be able to read with an interactivity. And the last is they wanted people to be able to read meditatively. So I think really as the vibration increases, and we know that there is scientific evidence now that will back up the truth, that people's minds that are located with their heart are expanding.
Yes.
Right. So I think people can hang with this now. There was a very short period of time in 1978 when a few people were talking about life charting. So there was two options. One would be to journal with a group of people. And you know, I've had a couple of huge revelations today on account of Wilhelm Reich, but we're going to add something new to this life chart now. And what it is it's the thing that's going on at hand in the world right now that leads you back to that very thing that is a trauma that keeps people from being able to create discernment instead of judgment. It allows them to forgive themselves and to forgive others, when they go through the exercise, they almost see it as the observer instead of being the victim of whatever happens, whether it's in the world or within their own home.
Yes. Yeah. I get exactly what you're saying here.
Good. Good.
Let's talk a little bit about what life charting is and how it works so that we fully explain ourselves as we go through this.
Do you mind telling me what time it is? Because you know I want to keep this right.
You're fine. You've got, you're a little under halfway mark right now. So you've got 34 minutes.
Thank you.
About 30 minutes.
All right. So like I said, we did have an option where we could journal in a notebook. That would be familiar to people, say like a diary or something. And they may come together in groups to discuss their experience. But oh my goodness, it takes so much time and energy to really just chart your own experience. And of course, as we know, sometimes other people's reality can affect ours. And in any good alchemical experiment, we really shouldn't be necessarily exposing what we would like to manifest. Right.
Yes, yes.
All right.
Very much, I get that.
Good. So
this is why, by the way, group therapy and psychology doesn't work.
Whatever.
Psychology doesn't work either, but.
And you know why? Because they never took into account the spiritual human being. It's all a bunch of crap with drugs.
Well, you know, that's psychiatry. I will say that I think Carl Gustav Jung was the exception to that. He split that's with true. Freud and he went into the spiritual path. And as a result, we got a marvelous gift from Jung. But psychology and psychiatry today is analytical psychology that makes you sit there and weep over your past mistakes and tear your heart out and remorse and endless years of this is actually the way to get to a place of healing, what you referred to in our conversation, healing the inner child. We've all got one. It's wounded and we need to deal with it.
And you know what is something that we'll see as we go through the chart? You aren't necessarily capable at certain ages to go back and rescue that inner child, even if you knew that there was one. I knew there was one, but I surely couldn't go back for it. There was only going forward and staying positive. There's a Dr. Hugh Len that is about healing the inner child, and the Hawaiian word for it is ho'oponopono.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So in the chart, we work in 7-year cycles. And so the biggest thing that we have to get over is that the year you were born is your first year. And you know how you have a birthday party for your baby and you put one candle on the cake? Mm-hmm. You're really beginning the second year.
There's candles there. The first year is the natal year, which is rarely ever calculated in age.
And don't you imagine that we talk about the programming that holds people down.
Mm-hmm.
For them to think they're zero right from the go. And so we want to be able to illustrate that. That'll become important because people will want to collect pictures and data to put into years. It becomes important. We've all heard the stories that the first several years were protected by angels, and that's a beautiful thing. We also know that until the age of 7, the child really only knows their immediate surroundings in their home.
Mm-hmm.
I have many memories. I have an excellent memory. But say I knew I was at Scott Air Force Base when I was almost shot when I was 5 years old. I had no understanding of where I was. I was in a tall field of grass. Right. But they also say that people who have suffered great trauma at that early age cannot connect their soul and spirit generally. And I believe that's one of the reasons.
Yes, yes.
I've been given the opportunity to come forward and speak about it. My stories are true. They can be verified. And I know I'm being monitored. So there's no place to run.
After tonight, I'll tell you that.
There's nowhere to run and hide with this. No, well, I was by hard math.
There's not.
When the phenomena happened on September 1st, I didn't know it was heart math, but they obviously it was. And so we know now that they have the ability to measure all of our biofeedback and electric. Mm-hmm. Well, Wilhelm Reich again with the energy we put out, right? So during those years, Randy, we're working with the temperament of a person. And that would be the clinical things of personality type, which they will usually lay on a person as they are an adult.
Yeah.
But when we look at the seven soul types, and I'm going to bring this up, we're all striving to be the radiant type. See that down there at the bottom?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. And then you see we have the other six categories, and that feels like personality type. Like when you say someone may have a dominant personality, or someone may be aesthetic, or someone may have an introverted life. That's what that would all be about. Now, at the age of 9, the person, the child, whatever you want to call the divine being, realizes that there's a great big world out there and that they are a part of it and do participate in it. So that's like think of it as an initiation point. They realize what they've always believed isn't necessarily what it seems. Mm-hmm. Now, surely during those first 7 years, the programming is beginning. The belief that you are your parents. And we all have a very distinct role. I mean, our parents serve. They're really there to give us moral guidance. And we all know how well all those things worked out. So, you know, there needs to be a lot of work with these things, right?
Yeah.
When puberty hits, we're going to shift out of temperament, and we're going to take the picture in that their soul is coming to their forefront. And so that is, interestingly enough, they question everything they believe, and they don't know why they believe it. They're also tempted by the seven deadly sins, and the ego development begins.
Yeah.
At puberty.
Right. Ego differentiation, I guess, is what they call it, right?
I think that's a brilliant term for it. Because, of course, we...
That's the rebellion that you get at puberty. Yeah.
Right. So, at 20 to 21, now this is the one that's the big kicker. The spirit comes to the forefront of the experience. And it asks the individual, whether it's on a conscious level, like right in your face, or unconscious way back here, it asks, will you continue to learn and grow, or do you know everything? Now think about how many people that you've ran across in your life that at 21, they knew it all. So here we're at another initiation period where the choices we make at any given time, of course, give us many different paths. And to me, I think that's what multidimensional reality is. I know what I experienced when I was young was real. I mean, as far as I experienced it, I was burned. I was almost shot. I went out and did this or that. It takes on a whole new meaning when you realize that we've experienced everything across humanity's entire time span.
Yes.
We're just kind of like actors on a stage and somebody hands us a story. Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Right. So 21 to 28 are considered the karma-free years. And all I can really say about that is that maybe by the grace and virtues and every other thing, that the mistakes and the decisions that are made during those years don't necessarily have to become a part of your true nature. You got a little play there to develop the ego. Now, everybody has been talking so much about ego, Randy. And Steiner, I love what he brings to it, because what we're really doing when we work with our ego, we're saying, this is who I am and this is what I do. And that work, of course, starts with us in our teenage years. Now, let's go back to say we're 28 and we're at the end of these karma-free years. If that person is committed, married, has a child, has a boss, whatever, their ego is saying, this is who I am and this is what I do. But their false ego says, this is who I am and this is what I want you to do. So now we're talking about the philosophy of freedom, in the sense that most people, out of the good nature and the love of their hearts, feel it is their job to control someone else and tell them what to do, while they avoid, they don't even know who they are. They're terrified of it. And that's the beginning of the end for so many people. Don't ever tell me that anybody at 30 years old is over the hill, because in all ancient cultures, you weren't even allowed to speak in public until the age of 35 to 40, which was considered the age of wisdom. Keep going. Okay. So.
Thread the needle.
Yes. We come into our crisis years between 30 and 33. Now, in modern day, I've seen that related to, of course, our DNA molecule and the whole Kundalini thing. But of course, it really goes back to the illustration of a man by the name of Jesus taking a walk to become the Christ, and surely telling us that we are all to take that walk to Christhood. So I'm not Bible thumping or anything, but I do want it fully understood that any of Rudolf Steiner's works and anything that I bring to the table, I believe is very Christ-centered. And, you know, we see so much now about at least being able to deal with the reality that we have a little itty bitty spark of the divine creator in us. And we can choose to grow a plant or a tree, or we can let it crumble and turn to dust and let the other side take over. That to me is sovereignty. All right. As we continue these crisis years, they go all the way to 49. You know, so now we have a double cycle of 7 years that we're discussing. And at 35, that's usually when most people are starting to feel that thing they call a midlife crisis. It is during these years that the false ego must be tamed and eventually eliminated, so the spirit man can come to the forefront of the experience at 40 years old. Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Cool.
Yeah.
The 40s are what they call the angel years. So I think that very many of us realize that there is more than the material physical world at that juncture in our lives. 49 is interesting. It's a major initiation year. It's called the year of the priesthood. So back again to initiation. If we have friends and loved ones along the path that don't meet those, they don't step up and take that initiative. Mm-hmm. You don't have to master it. You just have to try, right?
Right, right.
Open your heart to it. Right. So if they can't do that, after the age of 49, you usually see that rapid decline in health. It is where it shows. Where people like us, our 50s is a renaissance. We get to recreate ourselves, expand our careers, do something that might actually serve humanity. I mean, I've always served my clients, but to take it out on a broader spectrum, I think is what our 50s is all about.
Well, so far you're tracking with me perfectly. I mean, that's been my experience. This is, you know, some of this I thought about before. Going back to 33 for a minute.
Yes.
Obviously, you know, the Christ was kind of the model for that, but there's a book called Cosmic Consciousness by Richard Morris Buck. Have you ever read that? That book details the lives of Spinoza, St. Paul. Oh, there's probably about 30 different men in there. And they're mostly men, but there are some women as well. Mm-hmm. The age on or around 33 is considered to be the age when we go into our enlightenment period if again, we're doing the work, if we're walking the walk. So, you know, all of this makes complete sense.
If we raise ourselves from the dead and eliminate the dross.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah.
Right. So, 50s is awesome. Now we roll into our 60s. And once again, we have a look at these karma-free years. To me, that is just such an expansive statement that I really can't find good enough words to service it. At 70... Is it 77 or 72 years? I'm not sure which one. And you know me, I'm rolling live and I'm not going by notes and it's just.
Right. No, that's okay.
Just, I'm not going to say.
Well, we can come back and adjust some of the stuff later on, update the information.
Right. And I'll get in the books and I'll never.
We'll have lots of people on YouTube that'll want to correct us anyway. So
that's cool. Whatever they need to do, I just.
Yeah. Yeah, I get that.
They need their chance. But anyhow, a complete human cycle, I believe, is 72 years. I'm gonna stand on that.
That's actually kind of my understanding as well.
Good. Now we get to the age of 84. And this is something that I know someone is gonna be able to connect for us completely. At 84, the person feels like, or the individual being feels like, they've seen and done it all. They say that's because the planetary alignment is the same as when you came into the world.
Oh.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Isn't that cool? So now we can understand why so many wonderful people choose to check out shortly after their 84th year. Because in my belief, we make the choices, just like the person in the hospital. Some of them want their friends and loved ones with them when they pass, and they will hang on till everyone's there and make the transition. And you know, if they don't want anybody there, they're going to go when they're alone. The human body, as it's designed today, as sickly and poisoned as we are, can go to 120 years old. That's the human life. But Steiner was all about, too, the life between what they called death and rebirth. So now, and I hope it doesn't shatter the reality of any of your listeners.
We are. We never shatter reality here. No, we never do that.
I know. But they are eternal, wonderful, spiritual beings that have been getting in the butt since the point of origin. And, you know, I think that what that might be what it comes down to. And I think we talked about it. What if, Randy, in this wild game, that we go back to the zero point, to the point of origin, and we're all these little sparks or whatever we want to be, right? And each one of us is handed the most beautiful individual gift from this creator God. And all this shit in between, the way the karma works and the different things, has to do with what we did with that gift in that initial moment of creation. Wouldn't that be a trip? It's just a thought from a hairdresser, okay? It's take it light. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
Right. I want to show you something, though. And I have a lot of things, and you know I'm a little bit excessive. I want people to understand this. Like, I have a dear friend, a client, and she's suffered things in her growing up. And she says, you know, Suz, there's years that are blocked that I don't have any memory. And I'm like, you know, if you focus on the ones that you do have, and you've got your pictures, and you've got your silly vaccination records, and you've got your report cards, you've got your yearbooks. There is such a plethora of information a person can grab from if they open up their mind to what they can do instead of focusing on what they can't do. And we know that's key with what's going on anyhow. So everybody has always known me to not be perfect. And I'm cool with that. So a lot of people want to be perfect and they wait until every detail is just right before they even think about doing something. I've always been the other way. You know, I'll bring it and hopefully it'll be good enough for people. So I'm just going to show you some variances on life charting. Okay. 10 years between 1982 in 1992, so I'm a young woman. This has to do with my career. And in one column, the things that were hard in my existence are listed. Mm-hmm. And all the blessings that came to me are on this side, right? So I'll just give you guys one example, because when you say, hey, Suz, I want to get to know you, believe me, it's all documented, and I don't want people to get bored. I want them to be able to put themselves in the same shoes that I'm walking in and do it for themselves. So for your audience, let's get a little humor here. My last name was Glasscock before I got married. So I actually had a hairdresser guy tell me that he would never hire me unless I changed my name. And he was dead serious. He was the big, cool Italian guy, and I didn't fit his mold. Now, on the positive side of that year, 1983, I was the top of my class. My grade average was 94%, and I became an independent contractor. And so that was 19 years old, you see. And there'd be, like I said, a whole list of them. But this is one way to life chart. It's like a pro and con chart. But I want to stress and illustrate that the things that happened to me were hard are not a con, and they're not negative. They actually motivated me to great heights. So I have to be grateful that I was handed the experience. Okay. I don't know that you've know this about me yet, Randy, but we moved into our 117-year-old historic home in 2010, December.
Nice.
The Good Friday tornadoes hit Easter, April 19th, 2011. So this is a good way to let people understand that we survived it. And look at how beautiful our home is now and why we defend it the way we do, because this is our life and this is our community. This is a great one. I'm really proud of this one. I work with homeopathy. And so this online journey, I've met so many great people. I saw a YouTube of Santos Bonacci's. I hope I'm saying his name right.
Yeah, that's correct. Yes.
I love him. And so here he was working with a tissue salt therapy chart, which is the homeopathy that we use. The Schlesser tissue salts that were the original form of medicine down through the ages. And did you know, Randy, that in 1929, when nobody had a dime, they outlawed homeopathy. And they told the doctors that worked in the hospital, if they chose to use homeopathy anymore, that they couldn't work in the hospital. That's why people our age remember hearing stories of the doctor that would come to the house and still treat the family and was like a member of the family.
Yeah, yeah.
That's because he blew out of the hospital. He was forced.
That particular, what you're talking about there, that was done by John D. Rockefeller, who himself throughout his entire life had a personal homeopathic physician, but forced allopathic medicine on the rest of us through subsidizing Harvard Medical School and successively all the other medical schools in the country to go into allopathic medicine instead of homeopathy.
Well, and Randy, the gossip is that even the royal family or whoever they are.
Sure.
Okay. They actually have a homeopath right there at the castle. They don't take none of the crap medicine that they're handing out to the peasants.
No. All of these drugs, all of these treatments, everything that they're doing, the cancer treatments and everything is designed to kill us early, dumb us down in the process, and take our money while we're still productive. So,
yes, sir.
You have just to give me a time here, you got about 3 minutes. So,
okay. No, I'm just kidding.
Put a cherry on top.
All right. This would be my father's life chart. My dad was a policeman, and so it can answer questions about his trauma. This is my daughter's life chart. So you see, each one is different. I'm not trying to expose anyone. I'm trying to instill creativity in the audience. Here would be another chart. This one's pretty wild. We don't even want to talk about that. And this would be my mother's. So we talked a little about my mom, and we'll have another conversation another day. But through these things, I was able to completely love them and forgive them. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. And it's their journey.
What we just saw there is life charting. That's right?
Yes, sir.
What we just saw there was a visual representation of life charting.
You are correct.
Okay. Because that's a good visual for people to understand how we do this. Now, to review a little bit real quickly.
Okay.
We are life charting from our natal year In other words, year one being the first year from inception forward, we are charting our cycles in 7-year cycles. Is that correct?
Yes, and this is very important. So sorry. We have 4 categories in this chart. We're adding a 5th one tonight. But the 4 are destiny, illness, and that would be your ego pattern. Then you would have interest and studies, and that would be your soul aspects. You would have your people and family, and that's your life aspects. And then your places and your jobs are your physical aspects. But I suggest and recommend the idea, and of course I don't have that book right by me, but we talked about 1970 being a big year. A lot of things happened on the planet, and they actually are also at play with who the personality becomes, just like the mother and the father. We also have the world conditions. So people that are asleep think kids have a lot of fun when they go to school and that they're just having this carefree time, where we know truly stress levels in our youth are skyrocketing. So it's very difficult for someone in a different situation to understand how this can be. If we get it down in a chart, I believe that it will not only help anyone who looks at it, and of course, primarily the person doing the work, it helps, but it leaves a legacy, it leaves a continuance. So if someone's going through something and they want to explain to their child who they are, but the child is too young, mm-hmm. they say, well, I'll do it in 20 years. What if you're not here to do it in 20 years? Or they don't have the mentality.
You have 1 minute here. That actually leads us to the purpose of your YouTube channel, which you have been chronicling on these various subjects as a message to your grandchildren.
Yes.
Where can people find you and what can they find?
Well, on YouTube, I'm Suz Pratt, short and simple. I think my new persona on Facebook is Susanna Red, and you can find me on my page. It's Suz B. Pratt. You know, I don't even know where to find myself, Randy. I didn't even know how to send an email 4 months
ago. It's okay. We'll create some links for that. We have your YouTube channel. We'll put short URLs up, and we are going to have you back to do a second round with us because we really just began to touch on the information, and there's so much to say. I want to thank you for coming on, and we will get back in touch with you shortly. We're always in touch anyway. So
I was going to say, I hope to do many shows.
Yeah. Anyway, that will wrap it up for this hour. Suz Pratt has been with us talking about, rewind the audio and video and see for yourself.
Hi.
We're going to take a break here. We'll be back on the other half of Off Planet TV with a very interesting subject. We're going to talk about autism and a mother's journey for wholeness for her child. We will be